A rider, 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 ride. Elevation Nation Tribe. Thank you. I appreciate y'all for supporting and joining and tuning in. It's God Body Sean, Elevation Nation Conversations. Hit that like, share, subscribe button. Much respect and salute to the great Dr. King. Today is his day. It's his birthday. They made it a federal holiday. You know, but they didn't have to make it a federal holiday. We're going to take a day anyway. So we take a day, but we take a day to put in work and to better ourselves and a betterment. But I wanted to salute to Dr. King, but there's somebody that can say it better than I can. You know how you know when you're not up to par and somebody else can do the job better than you, then as a man, you humbly let them do it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to let my man, Professor Black Truth, speak on the real Dr. King and you know, give him, a eulogy or his praise in his with his great oratory skills, Professor Black Truth. So I'm going to let him speak on the real Dr. King. The Dr. King that was about business, standing on business. That was about reparations. That was about, you know, getting his. So let me read this copyright disclaimer. Label real quick. Hit that like, share, subscribe button. Drop a comment in the comment section. So we got to get the subscribers up. But I need to read this disclaimer tag real quick because this is not my video. This is Professor Black Truth's video. But he said it better than I ever could even think about saying it or speaking on the great Dr. King. So it says, copyright disclaimer under Section 107 of the Copyright Act 1976. Allowances made for fair use for purposes such as criticism, comment, news reporting, teaching, scholarship, and research. Fair use is a use permitted by copyright statute that might otherwise be infringing nonprofit, educational, or personal use tips. The balance in favor of fair use. So fair use, fair use, fair use. Giving credit, what credit is due, this is Professor Black Truth, but he's speaking on the great Dr. King, and he's breaking it down way, way better than I can do it. So we'll let him get to it. I'm out. Salute to y'all. Salute to Dr. King. Like, share, subscribe. Drop a comment in the comment section. Share the video. Share the video. Share the video. I appreciate y'all. Peace. We out. One love. God Body Sean.
This is the moment of truth.
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, this is what we are faced with, and this is the reality. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
America freed the slaves in 1863 through the Emancipation Proclamation of Abraham Lincoln, but gave the slaves no land or nothing in reality, and as a matter of fact, to get started on. At the same time, America was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that there was a willingness to give the white peasants from Europe an economic base. And yet it refused to give its black peasants from Africa, who came here involuntarily in chains and had worked free for 244 years, any kind of economic base. And so emancipation for the Negro was really freedom to hunger. It was freedom to the winds and rains of heaven. It was freedom without food to eat or land to cultivate, and therefore it was freedom and famine at the same time. And when white Americans tell the Negro to lift himself by his own bootstraps, they don't look over the legacy of slavery and segregation, I believe we ought to do all we can and seek to lift ourselves by our own bootstraps. But it's a cruel jest to say to a bootless man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. And many Negroes, by the thousands and millions, have been left bootless as a result of all of these years of oppression and as a result of a society that deliberately made his color a stigma and something worthless and degrading.
This is the Black Grassroots Remembrance of Dr. King. But in order to remember something, you need to know the accurate version of what happened. For a people who are truly empowered, they don't get their knowledge of themselves or their heroes from their oppressors. We have to be honest with the fact that there has been a false version of Dr. King that has been enforced upon the world by the white media, and it was done specifically to distance you, or rather to get you to distance yourself, from the real Dr. King. Dr. King was the subject of countless smear campaigns. Most of the lies and harassment that Dr. King and his family endured originated with J. Edgar Hoover's FBI, sending phony letters to his home, making harassing phone calls, and white power used some turncoat Negroes to push these lies too. Now, there were a lot of lies that the white supremacists could have used to try to discredit Dr. King, to undermine him, but they used the lie about infidelity for two reasons. First, they knew the power of the civil rights leaders like Dr. King was based on the public understanding that these men were morally right. The public's clear understanding that the black community is the voice of morality was what gave the movement its irresistible force. So the FBI, along with other bad actors, pushed the lie about King and adultery because they wanted to undermine the moral legitimacy of the movement. And saying a lie that big that Dr. King was having affairs, and worse, having affairs with white women, that was seen as the perfect way to do that. After all, there were a bunch of good white liberals who actually were just looking for the first chance they could to ditch the movement, having gotten their photo op. Charlton Heston comes to mind. But the second reason that the character assassination of Dr. King as an adulterer was so attractive to the FBI was that they also hoped these lies would pressure Coretta Scott King into divorcing Martin. If they could have made that happen, that would have been a huge victory for the enemy, to turn Dr. King's own wife against him and to do it with lies. Only it didn't work. They spread the lies far and wide, spread them to people in the movement, people who Dr. King had known. But Dr. King's reputation was so ironclad for the people who actually knew him that the lies simply couldn't take hold. They couldn't get people to abandon him. The lies about morality were simply not being believed. It's been over 50 years since Dr. King's assassination. J. Edgar Hoover was still alive at the time that he was killed, and for several years afterwards. Now, common sense would tell you that if J. Edgar Hoover was still the FBI director after King was assassinated, and if he had any dirt on Dr. King, wouldn't he have made it public a long time ago? Yet no such evidence has ever been revealed, because it doesn't exist. You have plenty of phony articles and people claiming this or that, but nobody in 50-plus years has ever presented any proof. The lies about King having affairs was an FBI COINTELPRO campaign, pure disinformation, an urban legend promoted by anti-black racists. The lies were that there were audio, video, recording, surveillance film. For 50-plus years, these rumors and claims have been circulating, and to this day, not one shred of any of these forms of proof has ever come to light. It seems at least once a year, some online publication or other will claim that an alleged confidant or somebody who allegedly knew Dr. King or allegedly met him or was in the back of the march that he conducted, somebody will claim that they saw him in a hotel with some woman who wasn't his wife. That's one of the lies the white media and its boosters in the society told about him. Another was that Dr. King didn't believe in radical changes to the society to balance the wealth gap. If you actually read what Dr. King wrote, if you actually listen to his speeches like the Three Evils speech, you find out that's not true at all. The Dr. King presented to you by the white media isn't the real one. What the white media did was to manufacture a toothless, sanitized, phony version of King in their image. One meant to get us to stop fighting white supremacy and instead hope that we can just wish the savages into civilized behavior. In other words, a version of Dr. King that would tell us lies about letting the status quo stand, in the hopes that if it stands long enough, maybe it will change. Nothing changes unless you make it to change. Dr. King understood that. That's what he was doing. You see, the enemy doesn't want you to know the real Dr. King. All they want to tell you is that he had some kind of dream, and even then they can't tell you the entire speech.
But I must confess that that dream that I had that day has at many points turned into a nightmare. Now, I'm not one to lose hope. I keep on hoping. I still have faith in the future. But I've had to analyze many things over the last few years, and I would say over the last few months. I've gone through a lot of soul searching and agonizing moments. And I've come to see that we have many more difficult days ahead, and some of the old optimism was a little superficial, and now it must be tempered with a solid realism.
The real Dr. King may not have been strident or hyper-aggressive with his rhetoric, but he was utterly uncompromising. When it came time to call out the hypocrisy from the dominant society, he did so without blinking, and he didn't care who didn't like it. Though he did care a great deal that his people know it. But you won't know any of that if all you heard about is the white media telling you about the dream and that's it. Go and discover Dr. King for yourself. You'll walk away with a totally different impression of him. Take out some time to acquaint yourself with the real Dr. King. When you do, you'll find that the image of Dr. King as an intentionally unoffensive man wasn't true at all. When the enemy realized that they couldn't defeat Dr. King outright, they certainly couldn't overcome his message and couldn't drive wedges between him and his wife or him and those who followed him. Instead, they killed him and then spent their time trying to co-opt his message, to twist it, distort it, pervert it, water it down, to take everything that he stood for and miseducate the public by presenting a fraudulent version of the man, one who was no threat to white power. This was done in order to alienate the younger generations of black people from what Dr. King was and what he truly stood for. To put forward the idea that while young black people were in the streets fighting for change, well, Dr. King, all he stood for was not hurting white people's feelings. But the truth always gets the last word, because what they did to Dr. King is what they're now trying to do with reparations. They tried to drive a wedge between Dr. King and his wife, but that failed. So after his death, they tried to drive a wedge between Dr. King and the black community, to say that he was colorblind and nothing else. He only thought about kids playing together. This was done to make a lot of us think that that was all there was to him, that he was some sort of naive dreamer and best left forgotten, that he wasn't relevant. And a lot of black people went for that. That is, until some other folks started actually reading up on the man and reminding people what he truly stood for, going beyond the commercials. But you'll notice the one thing that Dr. King didn't say when he was talking about coming to get our check. He talked about what we're owed, about what we're coming for, and how it's ours. He said a lot of things. But the one thing Dr. King didn't say was that we were asking for our check. Because he wasn't asking, and neither should we. The enemy is still running the same old plays, still repeating the same old lies about him. We have to be ready with some plays that they haven't seen. The reason that we remember our heroes like Dr. King is so that we can draw strength from them. Their struggles should not discourage you. They should inspire you, remind you that you're part of a continuum of the longest, most important fight for freedom in human history, right here in the U.S. What Dr. King wanted for his people was that we come to know who we are for ourselves, and armed with this knowledge, we would fight to be able to live our lives and make the most of it. His dream was that the empowerment of his people would become reality. When you bring up the real Dr. King, you'll find the phony liberals and the self-proclaimed colorblind conservatives get real uncomfortable. The version of Dr. King that they invented was supposed to be a validation of the dominant society. But when you tell them what Dr. King was really about, when you remind them what he really stood for, they get their feelings hurt, because they find out what Dr. King really thought about them. And his true feelings don't lend themselves to a I have a dream cardboard cutout that the white media manufactured. The reason that they hate Dr. King is because he showed what a real hero is. He was somebody who they could never match up to. None of their own little white supremacist icons measured up. They looked at him and he reminded them exactly how small, how puny, how insignificant they are. That while they had to invent lies about how their heroes were moral, Dr. King did it for real. And that just ate them alive. They looked at him and saw everything that they were not and could never be. This is why states like Florida want to ban books about Dr. King. Because the people who he fought for were talking about the real Dr. King, and the racists don't want that to go any further. Except they can't stop us. Honoring Dr. King is about reclamation, reclamation of our past, reclamation of knowledge of ourselves, reclamation of our power to define who we are on our own terms. Seeing one of our icons the way he truly is, it's about self-determination. We decide who we honor and who we don't, and we do it based on whether that person honored us and empowered us specifically. We honor Dr. King the way that he wanted us to, not begging for permission from the white government or hoping that they will acknowledge it so we can have a day off. We don't ask for a day, we take a day. Today is Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday, which coincidentally also falls on the same day as the federal holiday, but we don't care about the federal holiday. We owe it to ourselves to become acquainted with the real Dr. King, and do not care how that makes anyone else feel. Why? Because that's what our Dr. King, the real Dr. King, spent his life doing. And it was a life well lived. Good day, and be one.
If you have a business or a business idea, here are three.
All right. That was a good brother, Professor Black Truth, speaking on Dr. King. Way better than I can. And I always found that interesting. A lot of the information that they have about Dr. King that they don't share with us, as far as how he really was and what he was speaking on, is, you know, about reparations and about America and about, you know, the black man and racism and things like that. So I just had to tap in on that one, show some honor and respect to the great Dr. King. Professor Black Truth said it way better than I could say it, so I just had to, you know, tap in with him and plug that in. So go check out his channel. It's God Body Sean. Like, share, subscribe. Drop a comment in the comment section. I'm out. I'll talk to y'all later. Peace.